Oké. Okay. The subsumption architecture. That is very often with it used principle of design. The one most with it important is that there are several behaviors defined. They all work together in parallel. So each of them takes the sensor output, and each of them sends out some actuator commands. And the architecture makes sure that the correct behavior gets control over the actuators. But in principle, they all process the information at the same time in parallel and all come to a certain conclusion. But not all conclusions are executed. You see a layering in all those behaviors. That means that it is really a hierarchical layering. That means that the system is built from bottom to top. And on the bottom are the simplest but also most essential behaviors. They make sure that the robot survives. And the higher ones make sure that you can do some more complex tasks. All those different layers, they are certain task-achieving actions or behaviors, and in the different program language, they are sometimes called differently. But you can often see that they have the same sort of names. What you often find the sort of component that is called avoid obstacle or find doors, transfer with it a corridor, or with it or something else. And that's completely with it different than the previous with it design, because. Previously, with it, those things were organized vertically. The layers are with it horizontal. The most essential are at the bottom, but in principle, the higher ones are in control and can overrule the lower with it, behaviors. It means that the lower ones are closer to reflexes, and there is more deliberation on the higher end. That means that the higher end can be a little bit slower as long as the lower ones are fast enough to react if there is danger. So the lowest layers are the most basic with the tasks and that's always be there. And nice is that if you build from bottom up, that you also make sure that you can do the basic things first and then continue and reuse part of that effort to make more complex tasks. So all those rules are active at the same time. It is not that first the one or the other is, but all are active with it at the same time. With the current processors, that's no problem at all. Typically, you have 4, 8, or 12 cores, so running with it several programs at the same time is currently with it a standard. But in the 80s and the 90s, that was really something where they had to put some effort in to execute all those rules in parallel. What's nice is that you can evolutionarily build up your architecture by adding new components and new layers, and you can often reuse many of the elements from the lower ones. So it becomes every time easier to add another layer. So we talked a lot about those layers, what is in it. This is the examples from Brooks. And there it's really with it very easy. You have one sensor, the sonar, and that's read out twice by two different pipelines. First is the runaway with the pipeline, the other one's the collide pipeline, and both are controlling another part of the robot. One, the heading, and the other one, the speed of the robot. What the collide easily detects if there is an obstacle in front of the robot that is so close that you are afraid for a collision, then the motor gets a halt command and the robot stops before the obstacle. On the other hand, you have to feel force, and if you see objects in front of you or the side of you, then you're turn away from those obstacles. That means if you're standing still in front of an obstacle, you start with it turning, and then the collide detects that there's nothing in front of you anymore, and then you start driving again. Okay, that if you do that in a corridor, then you can start bumping from with it one side to the other endlessly. So that's a little bit stupid behavior. So the easiest way to get further, that's adding some random behavior in it. And what you do is that you add a new sensor that is on the top left, the encoders. There you see how much distance you're traveling, and based if you make a lot of with it progress, then with it you're with it happy. If not, then you're starting to do something about the heading. And here you see that there's a new avoid part, and that is also evading obstacles, but it takes as extra parameter a required heading. So if you're going straight for an obstacle and you can choose left or right, then you ask for the wonder what the preferred heading is. And based on that, you choose if the heading says left, the left one, or if the heading says right, the right evading. And here, on the right side, you see with the green circle, the first example of the really subsumption. The avoid has a certain with it, heading, and that overrules the heading that is submitted by the runaway. And that's where you what you now see is that the higher level, level one, overrules the lower level, level zero. So in that sense, it's in control. But it does it with a timestamp. So the control signal is giving for 10, 20 seconds. If there are no new subsumption signal is coming, then the runaway takes over with it again. So you can only overrule it for a short period of time. And every time if you want to overrule it again, you have to send a new submission signal. So if you have level one, you can also build a level two on top of that. That's the corridor following. There you, you still use the sonar to look for obstacles to the left and the right, and there you find out what is the middle of the corridor, and you give that as the preferred heading, and that is done. And what you see on the right side is that this higher level has a little bit more intelligence because it's integrating all those sensor readings towards from pure with points to lines, and in that sense it can know what the heading of the corridor is. Every time what you see is that you get a finite state automata that are sort of rules that every time say what the conditions are and what the controls should be with it given. You see here a transition from one finite state to the other one, and these are augmented finite state automata because there is also a timer involved, and that is part of the subsumptuous signal to only overrule it for a certain time. So if that time elapsed is gone, you jump back with it to the previous state. Jonathan Cornell has done a lot of bio-inspired work in making up the behaviors that you also can see in nature. One of them is the water with it, snails that are with it searching for cavities just above the water line. And by combining a combination of first going up, then with it going into a cavity, then with it, if it's still wet, look for with it something bright, and continue that until you find a cavity that is above the waterline, and then you have a stop behavior. And in that sense, you can make with it really with it the sort of behaviors that you can also see in nature. It's that same augmented state final machines that we've seen before. And that is actually with it tested also by Cornell on real robots. This is then an example of the robot that was collecting soda cans. And it was able to move around without hitting any obstacles. It was able to find soda cans, and it was able to pick them up and bring them to the waste. What was the overall behavior that you can see from this robot? It looks like if it was looking for soda cans. So it had a wonder behavior that it tried to cover as much ground in the office. Once, based on the camera and the laser scanner, it saw a soda can, it started to approach it. When it was close enough, it was partly measured by the laser scan, it started to extend the arm towards that soda can. The grippers were open. If there was something in between the gripper, they automatically started to close it. If the can was still heavy, you detected that the arm was not able to pick it up, so you opened the grippers again. If the gripper with it is closed and you can tuck in the arm, then with it you grab that empty soda can and head back towards home where you can drop it in the litter. So the nice thing is that this is really an example where you have different layers of behaviors, but in principle there was no internal state what has to be done and what should be done. It just made the combination what is currently can be sensed and what currently can be done, but you can with it play different scenarios after each other by starting the next behavior based on what you previously have done. And if you combine it how it looks like in a state diagram, then you can see that you have the different modules that on different places have the round circles with the S, that's the subsumption, where you overrule the other lower layer things. And you can build augmented state diagrams like this to build a robot like Herbert. So the nice thing is that there are no really with it internal wires between the layers. Still, you can have an emergent behavior. And the nice thing is that all those behaviors are not communicating by internal wires, but that they're communicating via the environment. Once you approach a can and you extend your arm, then you're sure that at a certain moment the can is between the fingers. And so the timing of that's signaled by the environment and not by the program. And that's really great because the environment is always the best model you can get. Getting the timing rights are really difficult. If you can do the timing signaled by the environment, that's great. Okay, that's precisely what you see. So based on this experience, Rodney Brooks, in his famous paper, Elephants Don't Play Chess, came to the conclusion is use the world because it's the best model there is. It is very detailed, it is always up to date. You never have incomplete data. So if you can provide information directly through sensing, then go that way. Because if you have first to store it internally, that slows you down, but it's also easily outdated, and then you have to get measures to also start to forget things again, and that's quite hard. So if you can rely on the directly available information by sensing, then you should do it. Okay, so we have different layers, and we saw quite complex schemes. How do you decide what goes where? That's always a difficult question. The experience is that there is no strict recipe, but some solutions work better. And the thing is that you can build it up historically. So start with simple things, test it, and then build up the next layers, and then you also need new modules. And what sort of modules you need, that depends on your robot, the environment, and what you want the robot to be done. So design and subsumption is in that sense the same, but also a little bit different in how you normally would design a program. First, you have to write down in pseudocode the sort of behavior that you need. Then you have to think about what triggers that task and what if you can decompose that in different components. Then for each of those components, look like what sort of granularity, how big that you want the rules to be. And then what it look like, how you can ground those behaviors in with the sensor that you have on the robot and the actuators that you have on the robot. Then you do the ground. And then start building it as fast as possible. Now, there are very different robots that this way of programming is tested on. One of them is Genghis, that's a sort of caterpillar robot. It could control how it walked. It could do a simple walk, but it could also, when it's a non-rotated flat floors, it could uh, balance itself. If one of the feet was dangling over after an obstacle, it could evade that obstacle. It had whiskers with it in the front, so it could also do evade big boulders. Another example, what was great, what was the PhD of Maya Matirich. She showed not only that you could do quite complex behavior as cleaning up with it, the office, not with a single robot, but with multiple robots. It also showed how you could extend the behaviors to a really big herd. So she had a team of 12 equivalent robots, and together they could show quite some complex behavior that actually is quite difficult to program if you do it purely determinately, but if you do it in behavior based, then it's quite easy to get emerging behaviors and let them cooperate and clean up the room together. Other examples that are built are just with a Lego style robots, Tom and Jerry, that could do a predator prey with a task. And what you can learn from all those examples that are built in MIT, that a lot of the design, how you make those layers, that is more an art than a science. So it gives a lot of freedom to the programmer, but in the meantime, it's also a weakness because there's no fixed recipe how you build it. But others think that that sort of crafty is the thing that you should expect from a robotic programmer. What's great on the subscription method is that it's implemented on a large number of robotic systems. It's the one that's most tested, and it's the first actually that also is commercialized, because it's the basic of the behavior of all the dust cleaning robots, the iRobots, because Brooks was the founder of that company. The nice thing is that the systems are built up from the ground, so every time you can add some extra complexity to the task. In principle, if you add those layers and those layers fail, then the lower ones kick in. In that way, it's really easy to test it. What's the downside of that approach is that still the top layers can influence the lower ones. So something that was working without the higher levels is not working anymore later on. So we've seen now how with subsumption you can create behavior-based control on a rule-based system, where you always react on what you currently sense. We see that purely behavior-based approach that can work quite good, as Maya Matirich has shown for even the robot herd. But at a certain moment, you want a more high-level task involved. That means that you want to get also deliberative systems coming in, and a lot of people try to make hybrids where the lower levels were behavior-based and the higher levels were deliberative. So the lower levels are the behaviors. That means that you are in collections with the rules of how they those behaviors are implemented. You have a number one that behaviors that try to achieve certain goals. You can also see that the behaviors have a certain time where they're active, and they're not active all the time, so that also other behaviors can kick in. And you can also see that the behaviors, they combine all the inputs that you have from the sensors, and that they can send control signals to the actuators and even also to other behaviors, so that you can build a whole network of behaviors that together can build up quite a complex overall behavior. So, in principle, behaviors are more complex than pure reactive actions, and you can also build far more complex emergent behaviors for it. So it's a little bit more than purely reactive actions. It's great of those behaviors that you can have different ones active at the same time. So it means that there's always one module that can react in real time. And although the behaviors themselves don't store the history, because you can have a sequence of activations, the network themselves can store some history and make sure that you don't show the same behavior always in the same circumstances, but how you come to that certain behavior can be stored in the network. But that means that the history is in the way that you build up your behavior network, your representation. So, to get it working, that means that you can have some difference in time scale between the lower level and the higher level, but in principle they should be aware of each other's time scales and should be not that far away. The moment that you, the lesson that's learned, if you make deliberative systems, then you really should pass an interface to come up with the advice that you get from deliberative systems, but you should not wait on it. So, in principle, a lot of people said it's quite difficult to show a more complex behavior with behaviors, but you can show that it's more than an action because you could use behaviors also to perform complex tasks as mapping. And that can easily be done by moving around randomly, always store at the moment that you encounter a wall, and together start to building a map, and you can even store the shortest path by looking what works and what doesn't work at that map. So, how do you represent such a map? That is something that's not in one global part, but you distribute it over different behaviors, and together in the network you get the behavior. And that's a little bit comparable if you describe a map of the city. It's often related with behavior, from what you should do, follow the water, more than precisely if it's in a circle or in a half circle or whatever. So what you do is that you connect parts of the map that are connected with each other, and when you should go from one behavior to the other, and in that way you have sort of behaviors, and it's also say the way how we create maps in our brain. So the network of behaviors represent are connected to locations in the environment. You make a sort of topological map of the environment, and in that way you can create a map of a city for a robot. And that was demonstrated again by Matirish with her robot Toto. So Toto was such a cylinder, and it showed different layers. And on top, you see two layers that normally are only seen in deliberative control. One of them is spot finding, and the one is map learning. What's part really important for the map learning is that you sense not only walls but also landmarks that are distinctive parts, because then you can store a certain topological location for a certain behavior in your network. How they would sense that is that they looked what were how the areas looked like. If it's cluttering, then it's a part that has to be cleaned up. If it was not cluttered, then you could go straight, and you could see if you go straight by your compass. And then you can also see if there were left or right walls, and then you were in a corridor environment. And what happened if you have here on the top right a map, and on each of the map you see certain tags. Each of those tags is a certain behavior, and on the lower right, you see a number of those circles with the same tags. Each of them is connected, and you can see how you can go from one behavior to the other one, and together they build up a network, and how you can circle that obstacle in the middle of the map. So each landmark is stored together with a behavior. If you encounter a new landmark, a new behavior with it is added to the libraries, and you are looking how you can get from one landmark to the other one, and if that's possible, then you're starting to connect those wires, and together they build a topological world model, and that's nowhere stored except in the network of behaviors. And how does that look with it in code? You see that it's a simple, with it, a rule-based approach. Okay. So in principle, Toto didn't keep a sequence of behaviors. Instead, there were constantly with it, messages passed between the behaviors, and that's great, because if there's somewhere and one of the corridors is blocked, then that signal's not given, and then the route is not taken. The only problem is that if there are multiple suggestions sent out, how do you choose where to go? The thing that they do is that they look at the size of the landmark. So that if the message are what it bigger, then the path length is bigger, and the path length is something that you want to evade. So Toto also always has chosen the shortest path by looking with it on the length of the messages. So each of the behaviors was executed one at a time until it reached the goal, and that worked fine. And I will add the video later on below this presentation. Okay, that's what I wanted to tell about design models, and I will now look in different ways of encoding them.